Yeah, I mean, it does so much work, and Storm Drain is probably one of the most frustrating abilities to play against in a long time. Of course, game is coming up, and we see the leads already. There it is. There's Gastrodon.
Yeah, James is not messing around. He sees his opponent has two water types on his team preview, and he leads Gastrodon and Rotom Heat. And Kyle on the top of your screen with Arcanine and Whimsicott is his lead. So I'd say a lot more traditional of a lead out of Kyle here. There's many avenues that this Whimsicott and Arcanine can go for.
Yeah, but we'll see exactly what this Arcanine is carrying. We did talk about it earlier, obviously moving away from Justified some of the time and being a little more supportive. One of its most popular supportive moves in Snarl would be great here. Rotom and Gastrodon, both special attackers, don't really appreciate taking a Snarl and their damage output being severely limited from that point on.
Yeah, the Arcanine, it's a Pokemon that can run physical, you can run special, you can run mixed, and those Snarl is great because it hits both of your opponent's Pokemon. This Moonblast, though, from Whimsicott will go into the Gastrodon here, bringing it down to about half of its HP thanks to a critical hit Snarl from Arcanine. So both of James's Pokemon will have their special attacks lowered by one stage, and a Volt Switch from Rotom Heat into the Whimsicott will break a potential Focus Sash that the Whimsicott would be holding, and James is going to have to switch out into something in the back, probably one of his Pokemon he would like to Dynamax in this set.
Yeah,
and that's Togekiss.
Togekiss is a great selection here, and I think the Gastrodon's going to struggle a little bit to deal the amount of damage you'd like it to.
Earth Power into Arcanine. Still does over 50% to the Arcanine, which is interesting since there was had its special attack lowered and there was no critical hit there. That Arcanine might not have a lot of special defense investment if it took that much from Earth Power.
No, I mean, that's a good amount of damage to get down with this Togekiss in a great position. One thing I think is very key here is the Whimsicott kind of admits that it doesn't have a Grass-type move. You'd go after the Gastrodon with it, unless he was predicting a switch out and didn't want to just throw out a Grass move into something that would take it comfortably. Then, you know, showing Moonblast could reveal, hey, I actually don't have the best answer, and that's why he's just kind of going after it. The Whimsicott, though, back to what it usually gets up to right now.
Tailwind on turn two for Kyle. That's going to boost, or that's going to double the speed of all of its Pokemon on his side of the field for four turns. Arcanine just going to keep up with the Snarls here. Does connect onto both of James's Pokemon. Of course, that's something we have to look out for. Since Snarl is 95% accurate, it does miss sometimes. This Air Slash, though, will definitely be enough to knock out Whimsicott, even through the Snarl decrease there. So now Kyle's going to have to bring something else into that slot, and Gastrodon will recover on this turn, going up to pretty close to full HP.
Yeah, I mean, James taking the first knockout, but I think the biggest issue here is both his Pokemon are going to be affected quite poorly by this Snarl. So if, you know, Kyle can sit there and just keep on going with Snarls, Gastrodon and Togekiss are very manageable at that point.
And this Duraludon switching in for Kyle here, you would assume, obviously, it's a Pokemon that likes to Dynamax a lot since it gets access to moves like Thunder and Solar Beam that wouldn't be effective if it's not Dynamax. So when you turn those into the Dynamax moves, they are a lot more effective. So you can expect potentially this Duraludon to go for a Dynamax here. And this Togekiss, that is not what he wants to see, is a Steel-type that would be pretty strong against it.
Yeah, a Steel-type that really enjoys going after those Togekiss. We might get a bit of information on the item it's carrying there as well. That could be important to see. But we've actually gone, you know, a good number of turns, two turns in this game already, with no Dynamax. Both players just kind of feeling it out, trying to spread around some moves and see exactly how they play. No more Snarls going on for the rest of this game, though.
No, but you will see more Intimidates when the Arcanine comes back eventually. Conkeldurr, though, is the reveal as Kyle's fourth Pokemon he brought in this matchup. No switches from James's end, though, so I wonder if he's actually keeping this Togekiss in and potentially using it as a Dynamax or saving one of the Pokemon in the back for later. This will be the Dynamax Duraludon, though, for Kyle, getting that that HP increase, doubling his HP, because it looks like he leveled him up with his Dynamax candies properly. So that's the first battle you always have to win when you're rebuilding. Make sure you build it effectively. And James is going to match his Dynamax with the Togekiss.
Yeah, I think that's a wise decision, is making sure your Togekiss can take something like a big hit. I mean, it has been Snarled, so it's not at full offensive power, but it's still in a good position. And we'll see exactly how this Togekiss deals with the threat of the Duraludon. Gastrodon keeping it real safe, though.
Yeah, Gastrodon will protect on this turn, though, so no damage. And if it was hit by an attack like a Max Overgrowth, that would be through the Protect. So this Max Overgrowth is only doing 25% of the damage that it would have if Gastrodon didn't protect. So that is a nice turn from James protecting his Gastrodon here. And now the Togekiss can try to go for an attack into Duraludon to bring that down pretty low. Here is the Max Starfall, though. And thanks to that combination, it looks like he might be holding an item there that helps him take special attacks better, but also because of the Snarl earlier, that Starfall does not do enough.
No, I mean, the Snarl, Duraludon being Duraludon and being able to carry items that really help, that Togekiss not as big a threat. I mean, on the positive, he changed the terrain back, so he's not getting any recovery on that side from the grassy terrain.
Yeah, but that's a big reveal that he does have. He does have the grass attack that it looks like Whimsicott might have been lacking.
Yeah, I mean, it's got to be somewhere on the team, right? Otherwise, you just take big losses to Gastrodon, and this Rotom switch back in. Really smart play to deal with that, but Duraludon's not trying the same thing again, and this Togekiss could be in a bit of danger.
Max Steel Spike into Togekiss will bring it down to under 50% of its HP, going to increase the Duraludon and Conkeldurr's defense by one stage, but they are facing off against two special attackers, so that won't matter. What will matter, though, is this activation from Weakness Policy on Togekiss, increasing both his attack and special attack by two stages. It barely hangs on with two HP from that Ice Punch from Conkeldurr, and here's a Max Airstream for your troubles. One hit knockout into the Conkeldurr, and now James's Pokemon have those speed boosts. Togekiss is faster than Duraludon. He can try to go for another attack. That was a huge survival from Togekiss to live on two.
Yeah, this Togekiss clinging on now with its weakness policy activated. I think, you know, it's going to be in a pretty good position to try and deal with the rest of the game. There's a lot of work that needs to be done from the two Pokemon on Carl's side of the field, and they're both taking a good amount of damage. Of course, Togekiss dangerously low, but being able to pick up a knockout and, of course, get the Airstream boost puts it in a great position.
And Kyle is down to his two last Pokemon, and we actually haven't even had James reveal his fourth Pokemon in this matchup yet. We've only seen these three, so obviously he's in a 4-2 lead with his Pokemon with the weakness policy boost still looking in a strong position. Of course, Rotom Heat now being faster because of that Max Airstream. He'll be faster than the Arcanine. He can get a fully strong Thunderbolt potentially into that Arcanine slot without getting snarled. And as I say it, he's actually going to switch out instead into the Gastrodon.
Doesn't need your help, Joe. He knows what he's doing. Togekiss is going to Max Guard. Doesn't want to get caught by anything on this turn. So the Snarl's not going to get there. And whatever follows up, probably not going to do the same. Of course, the Snarl.
It does connect on Gastrodon, though, which could be critical, you know, lowering his special attack by one stage. And Max Wurmwind, though, from Duraludon on this final turn of Dynamax for it will take down the Gastrodon. I think James, with a critical hit, I don't think he really needed it in that situation. He will be able to take that Gastrodon down, I think. James understood Gastrodon's utility was not as effective in this match since Kyle's two Pokemon he didn't bring were his two water types.
Yeah, and he also stalled out the Tailwind there, which I think is really important. That Tailwind, you know, set up much earlier in the game. Kind of easy to forget about it, but, you know, Kyle had the advantage in speed and was still losing Pokemon through that. James has been switching so well. He does reveal his fourth Pokemon in Excadrill, but I think, you know, there is a lot of work to do here. The Arcanine obviously wouldn't be the worst thing to try and deal with it, but Excadrill is going to be able to deal a lot of damage back. Next to Togekiss as well, there's nothing to stop you pressing Earthquake.
Right, that's some of the great synergy that this team would provide. Excadrill, obviously, Rotom Heat having Levitate, the Togekiss being immune as a flying type. Those are teammates that would love to sit next to Excadrill as he decides to Earthquake all day. And Duraludon and Arcanine are two Pokemon weak to Earthquake from this Excadrill, so it's definitely not an ideal situation for Kyle. Earthquake will go into the Protect, though, from Arcanine. This will hit Duraludon super effectively, though. Is it enough for a one-hit knockout? It is not. That Duraludon is able to barely hang on just a little bit. And Flash Cannon from Duraludon will take down Togekiss in those last couple of hit points it had remaining in this matchup. It's now two Pokemon to two with the Arcanine Duraludon versus Rotom Heat and Excadrill.
I think, honestly, the back two for James, this pairing is so much to handle. Of course, James has to be a little bit cautious with his Rotom. We do see a lot of Rotoms carrying those choice items. So if he does pick a move to try and, you know, tidy up the rest of this game, he could be in a good position, but it'd be interesting to see exactly what he has. Arcanine is moving first. Flareblitz could cause some issues with this Excadrill.
It's not. The Excadrill actually is knocked out here from that Flareblitz. So that Arcanine reveals to be physical and special with Flareblitz and Snarl.
Ooh.
And perfectly using Flareblitz recoil there because that will activate his Figgy Berry, recovering 33%. But this discharge will actually target both of Kyle's Pokemon here, knocking out the Duraludon and bringing Arcanine down low enough for that the next turn it will knock it out. So having that spread attack, that's great synergy with Excadrill again, right? Mm-hmm. As a ground type, that discharge, there was no loss to using it on that turn. Yep. There was no downside.
No, and I think this is a really big thing for James to reveal. I mean, he has to reveal it in game one, obviously. But, you know, as we saw, he positioned his team so well to say, hey, I have Excadrill and Rotom Heat in the back. You know, I'll lead Togekiss Gastrodon and play around with that a little bit, see what we want to do. You know, he got a lot of turns out of that pairing alone. And being able to set up for this Discharge and Earthquake combo, which has been around for 12 years now, something crazy, like 11 or 12 years, where Discharge and Earthquake has worked well together. You know, that's huge, and particularly when your last two are both weak to Earthquake and not the easiest to deal with, something like a Discharge. Of course, Duraludon was already very, very low from the Earthquake the previous turn, but James, managing the board state there really smartly, thinking forward and thinking about the next couple of turns always, to say, you know what? I think we're gonna put ourselves in a winning position at the end of the game.
And you wonder what adjustments Kyle can make here in game two, because the two Pokemon he had in the back are water types, which are weak to a discharge from the Rotom Heat. So you wonder if he wants to bring one of those Pokemon when it's one already weak to Gastrodon or hurting against Gastrodon, and two can potentially be hit very strongly from a discharge from Rotom Heat.
Yeah, I mean, I think if you're going to bring one, you have to bring Rotom Wash, arguably, to be a little better against the discharge,
right,
and avoid the Earthquake. But then you have to play the Rotom Wash very carefully around the Gastrodon. You want to be firing off Hydro Pumps. That's why you bring Rotom Wash.
That's why you bring Duraludon to get rid of the Gastrodon, so your Rotom Wash can take care of everything else.
Yeah, I mean, we're talking about things that revealed. Obviously, Discharge Earthquake was revealed by James in game one, but Kyle had to reveal that his Grass-type move lives on Duraludon.
Right.
And that's something that he's going to have to say, hey, if he knows about it, Duraludon can be targeted by a couple different options to try and get rid of it. And that's something he's going to have to be careful about.
Right, this Duraludon obviously is so key. One, because he's his Dynamax user for Kyle there, so obviously it's one of his important Pokemon that he brings into the matchup. But two, if that Duraludon goes down or is not nowhere to be found against the Gastrodon, it doesn't seem like Kyle has any ways of hitting Gastrodon super effectively. And that's really what a strategy that James's team strives off of, is people who are just forced to ignore the Gastrodon long enough for it to do enough to bring everything down low enough for one of his sweepers like Excadrill or Rotom Heat to take care of the rest.
Yeah, I mean, I think bringing that pair in the back is probably James's win condition again here. Regardless of what changes Kyle makes to his team selection, he has to be thoughtful about that. Try and catch Rotom Heat. We saw it switch in a couple times, you know, and show itself early. And I think dealing with that when you see it and you're given the opportunity is probably more important than we give it credit for.
And now Kyle has the information that James's Togekiss is Weakness Policy and not Babiri Berry. So if he's able to try to get a double target off into that situation, he knows the combination of Max Steel Spike and, say, another attack would be able to take it down.
Not Ice Punch. Ice Punch was not enough.
Apparently not that Ice Punch. I do wonder if it was close enough, you know, potentially for Kyle to try it again in game two. Maybe it just didn't roll in his favor in game one. But the Conkeldurr is an interesting bring in the matchup, because it's so weak to Togekiss with both of its fairy and flying attacks. But you really like Conkeldurr against Excadrill and Tyranitar. Like, how can you not bring that against a Sandcore?
It's hard to justify leaving Conkeldurr at home in this matchup. But as you said, I mean, the Weakness Policy was in play. It got felled very, very quickly by the Max Airstream, which is unsurprising. I mean, it's not like a Pokemon like Conkeldurr is known for taking Max Airstreams very, very well. But, you know, I think it's something that you have to think about. We also need to look at the fact that Kyle had Tailwind up in that game.
Right.
He should have been in the driving seat, I think, and really and controlling the game a little bit differently there, but just not able to take the full advantage of all those turns.
Yeah, usually when you do have Tailwind up, you are able to be able to use it effectively, or that's the idea behind it, is you now for the next few turns have the speed advantage. But with Dynamax, it's such a big factor when you double HP of a Pokemon who's already so bulky in Togekiss that you're not able to take advantage of it or use your Tailwind turns efficiently enough against it. So James was able to stall out the Tailwind until his Excadrill ended up being and Rotom Heat ended up faster than Kyle's Pokemon.
Yeah, well, players back around for game two. The teams obviously haven't changed. And, you know, I like James' selection. Honestly, I think James bought the perfect Pokemon. I think he respected the sand option very, very wisely. And I think Kyle did the same and said, you know what? I do have to bring Conkeldurr. I do have to bring Duraludon. Arcanine was a smart one. And I think the opening turns, you know, if James didn't start switching, the Snarl would have been a huge issue. But James played it smart. He said, you know what? I'm not going to let you Snarl me all the way down to no special attack. I'm going to switch. And he got away with the switches. There was no switch that he got really hard punished for and got caught with like a double target on the way in. So he put himself in a great position. And switching this year, it's been a little different with obviously Dynamax. You try not to switch it out. It does happen.
Right.
But, you know, it's one of those things that switching has opened up a lot of doors for James in that game. And causing those problems, the threat of something like Gastrodon in the back is always something that your opponent has to think about.
I'd like to see more of an aggressive lead here or turn one out of Kyle in this matchup because two of his four Tailwind turns were wasted where the only attack was a Snarl from Arcanine, which is, you know, obviously not a high damaging attack there. So something that actually lets him be an advantage on turn one more in this situation would be beneficial. But we are going to have the same leads as we did in game one with Arcanine Whimsicott for Kyle and Gastrodon Rotom Heat for James.
Yeah, I mean, there's another option here. We talk about team synergy on James's side. Rotom next to Gastrodon can discharge as well. There's no issue there. And maybe that's something he's going to go for. I mean, the Rotom did Volt Switch out, which I liked. It got some good damage down on this Whimsicott. But Whimsicott's forced into a Protect here, a move we don't often see on it.
Right, Whimsicott holding that Protect there, meaning it had to give up something else that it would like to have in that slot instead.
Probably the Grass type move.
you would assume that's where that grass move turned into Protect. Snarl, though, will connect onto both of James' Pokemon, just as it did in Game 1. But this time around, James does not fall for the Protect bait from Whimsicott, and we'll switch out into Togekiss in the back. All that's left on this turn is a potential Earth Power or Scald from Gastrodon. Gastrodon opts for Scald here, still hitting Arcanine super effectively, bringing it down, but that is low enough for it to activate its Figgy Berry, so he will recover a little bit here.
Yeah, getting that berry out of the way early, though, is pretty good. I mean, James, again, took the drop to special attack on his Gastrodon. But really, you know, not too worried about the situation. You know, he's managed to get some good damage down, deal with Arcanine's Berry. It doesn't have a way to get that back. So it's stuck with that amount of health for the rest of the game. And not falling for that Protect on Whimsicott is so smart. Realizing that, hey, Arcanine actually caused a lot of problems with its Snarls. And just going after it turn one, I think, is really smart adaptation from James.
No Dynamax here from the Togekiss, though. I was possibly expecting it to Dynamax, but instead it will have to eat this critical hit Snarl, which still does pitiful damage to it. so that's how that's a dark move onto fairy Pokemon for you. Air Slash, though, from Togekiss into Whimsicott will bring it down pretty low, not enough for a knockout, though. And this Scald from Gastrodon will be enough to take the Arcanine out. It does not look like it. Brings him down to pretty much where he was at before the Figgy Berry the previous turn.
Yeah, and this is James, something that he kind of did in the previous game, just taking the Snarls and getting the knockouts, right? So if he could get, let's say, a double knockout in this turn, you know, Air Slash and Scald would probably still get there. Then he's just up in Pokemon, and he can switch around so easily and say, okay, well, you got the Snarls down, that's cute, but now I'm just going to switch around, play through them, and then depending on what the last Pokemon in the back are as well for Kyle, you know, may just say, all right, well, I'll just buy time with these and do chip damage while I can. He is going to be playing in a Tailwind again, so Kyle really wants to get something like that Duraludon in it as soon as possible, I think, and go from there. But these two really not putting the pressure on from Kyle's side of the field, and James probably feeling pretty good about it.
We're going to see a switch out, actually, from Arcanine, and I believe the same exact moment that it switched out the last game into Duraludon. So Kyle is using the same strategy here, but there is an adjustment from this Whimsicott before it presumably gets knocked out from this Dazzling Gleam here. As it does take it out there. Fake Tears will lower the Togekiss's special defense by two stages, so that way next turn, when this Duraludon tries to go for a Dynamax, gets the burn there. It won't affect its attacks, it's just a special attacker, but it will take that residual damage every turn. Now this Togekiss is -2 on its special defense, and a Max Steel Spike would take it down.
Yeah, Max Steel Spike from based off Flash Cannon, obviously a special attack would definitely get it there. And that is forcing, this pairing actually forces a lot of pressure from James. So he's obviously got load special defense and special attack on Togekiss. He's got load special attack by a number of stages on Gastrodon. So he may be forced to switch. And based on how he played game one, he's already revealed Rotom again. So no reason not to expect Excadrill. If Kyle could capitalize on switches, he could get himself back in the driving seat really, really quickly. That said, this Togekiss has to leave. Because it's not even going to get the chance to activate its weakness policy in its current situation.
Yeah, this Conkeldurr is sitting here waiting in the wind for Excadrill to show up from James, which is what he expects for it to be that fourth and final Pokemon But the Ooh. It's actually an adjustment here for the Gastrodon switching into Hitmontop. So it looks like Exedrill was left in the box in this game too. This Intimidate will affect the Conkeldurr though, as he lowers his attack by one stage. And a Dynamax from the Duraludon here will make it pretty strong, and a potential Max Steel Spike into Togekiss would take it down.
Yeah, and I think maybe James here banking on the fact he's assuming that, hey, he's not going to think I'm going to leave the Togekiss in, and just going from that point and saying, hey, I'm actually going to leave Togekiss in, and I'm going to Dynamax it too. And I'm going to try and get some value out of it before it goes down. I don't think it's going to be as valuable as last time with the weakness policy activating. But maybe he's just trying to read into Kyle and saying, hey, I don't believe you're going to actually target this Togekiss.
So Duraludon typically can be trained faster than Togekiss, and he has Tailwind on his side. So we would assume Duraludon goes faster, but Max Wurmwind into this Togekiss slot. This Togekiss will not be punished as he expected. Kyle expected a switch out here, and instead he's going to have to take a Max Starfall into that slot. I was really worried for James that he was gonna use this Dynamax and get knocked out before it even got an attack off, but he just Dynamaxed for free and acted like nothing happened.
Hook, line, and sinker, he's got him there. I mean, he's called it and said, Kyle, I don't think you're gonna bank on my Togekiss still being there. Kyle has made a hard decision there to say, I'm gonna go after Max Wurmwind, probably thinking about the Excadrill, trying to lower its attack on the way in, you know, or something coming in like the Rotom, you know, Rotom in that slot, Excadrill in the other slot, so hey, you get a lot of damage down on Rotom, you get the lower health on Excadrill. But James, yeah, the damage isn't as much as you like because of those previous Snarls, but really smart. Max Guard going to keep it safe and a lot of pressure right now on this Hitmontop.
Steel Spike will go into that Max Guard here, and a Drain Punch from Conkeldurr into Hitmontop does a good amount of damage to the Hitmontop. Not enough to bring it down into the yellow, but close combat from Hitmontop will take down Duraludon with a critical hit. I really don't think that crit was needed. It was just more more salt in the wound in this situation, as Duraludon for two turns used an immunity attack in Max Wurmwind and then attacked into Max Guard, and that was perfectly played by James, as this Tailwind will peter out.
There's another thing I want to talk about in this team, and it's an interesting lineup. So we talked in game one about the item on Duraludon, and Duraludons are very commonly carrying Assault Vest. We saw the damage it's been taking, it's been so limited, clearly that's carrying the Assault Vest. So let's look at the other Pokemon on Kyle's team in Conkeldurr. Now, Conkeldurr likes Assault Vest. It's certainly one of the top options on Conkeldurr. But its second option, after grinding all the time and hoping that he gives it to you, Ball Guy can give you Flame Orb, and Flame Orb goes on Conkeldurr. So we roll it back a turn, and we say, hey, look, Togekiss stayed in, and it used Max Starfall, which set Misty Terrain up. So this Conkeldurr isn't able to get the full benefit of its item. And
there is the forfeit, though, from Kyle. So James is going to win that set.